Welcome to our service of worship, whether online or in person. A book of condolence for Her Majesty the Queen has been opened online by the Mayor of Antrim and Newton Abbey, Alderman Stephen Ross, for residents of the borough who wish to leave any personal messages or tributes through the borough website. If you wish to sign the book of condolence in person, this will be available in Ballyclare Memorial Park from 12 noon today, Sunday, and every day between 9 a.m. and dusk. As a mark of respect, the session have agreed to suspend all church organisations until after Her Late Majesty's funeral. Creche facilities are available in the hall during the service for anyone who wishes to make use of them. The Sunday Club continues today, preschool to P6 in the Coulter Hall, P7 to Year 12 in the Boyd Room. The PW service will be next Sunday, the 18th of September, led by members of both the PW and Jules. The guest speaker will be Louise Davidson, Deaconess in West Church, Bangor. These conclude today's announcements.
In time of light, in time of darkness, we gather in this place seeking the solace of faith and to be found by the mercy of the living God. With tears and with laughter, with the memories of the long years, on this day, we share that which is good and that which brings us comfort and hope. Let us pray. Lord God, we praise you for your love revealed in Jesus Christ. We thank you that your love is greater than we can ever imagine and stronger than death itself. So we know that we can trust you with our loved ones and with ourselves. We lift up our hearts in gratitude for all your blessings to us, and though we come as people burdened by anxiety and guilt, we rejoice in the forgiveness you always offer to us. Though we walk amidst the shadows of death, we celebrate your promise of new life. Though our hearts are filled with grief, we do not grieve as those without hope. In these days of national mourning, we recall with gratitude the late Queen, your servant Elizabeth, and the gifts which you gave to her, and all the ways in which you sustained her throughout her long life and reign. May the God of the open heart, and the Christ of the gentle joy, and the Spirit of the embracing love, grant to each one of us in this place of gathering the grace that enhances each life and community. Through Jesus Christ our Lord we pray. Amen.
I die.
loving God all through the country. Many people are sad at this time because the Queen is no longer with us. She will be missed by so very many, but we know that you are looking after her. Bless those close to her. May they know they are remembered by us. And bless our country at this time of change. May we all work together as one family and be ready to serve each other as the Queen served us. In Jesus' name we ask, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. All right. You can plonk down wherever you want or sit in the pews. So this week has had some really, really big news. Not just your birthday. Does anybody know what the news was this week? The Queen died, and it's been everywhere. The Queen was a very, very important person. And she was Queen for, does anybody know how many years? Any ideas? 70
years.
Brilliant. You listen to the news well, don't you? She was the longest ever Queen to reign, longest ever monarch to reign in the United Kingdom. So lots of people will be thinking about the Queen this week before her funeral. But the Queen was the Queen for so long that everybody knew her. I mean, I don't know, did anybody here in the congregation ever see the Queen in person, or was it an event or things like that? Because, you know, she's been around for so long, nobody knows who the Queen was. Except there's this, though. One of the things people said when they saw the Queen in person for the real time was, well, do you think she said, my goodness, she's the tallest person I've ever seen? No. What do you think they might have said? Well, the Queen always had hats, didn't she? So people would talk about her hats. But one other thing about the Queen was that sometimes when you saw pictures of her on the news and she was standing beside other world leaders, she wasn't the tallest person. In fact, sometimes the Queen was the smallest person in the room. The Queen wasn't that big. But do you know something? Whenever the Queen came into the room, it didn't matter how big or how tall who other people were, they all stood up. So even though the Queen was tiny, she had such a big job that everybody paid attention to her. The Bible is full of stories of little people with big jobs. Do you know that? We've heard of them sometimes. One of the smallest was Zacchaeus, but Jesus used Zacchaeus to help lots of other people. And in the Bible, we hear the story of King David. And King David had to meet somebody called Goliath. And Goliath was a giant, and David wasn't that big. He was only small and young. And yet God used him. And time again, there's people in the Bible who didn't feel very big, and they didn't feel very tall, and they certainly didn't feel very strong. But yet God could still use them. God has big jobs for little people. And that includes you. And the biggest job of all that God has given each of us is to love one another, just as God has loved us. And that's not words. That's the things we do. It's really down to earth, and it's really, really practical, and it's something that each of you could do. What are some of the things you could do that are loving? What are the kind of things you think that are kind? Any guesses or ideas this week?
Sharing?
Absolutely. That's a brilliant idea. Anything else you can do? Be kind. Absolutely.
Play with others.
Yeah, make them welcome.
Help
other people. Mums and dads, you listening? We've got a willing band of helpers here today. We can all help out at home and do things. You know what? I could ask you lots and lots and lots of things. Every single one of you has the biggest job in all the world. But yet, every single one of you can do it. Let's share a prayer. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you that you have big jobs for little people, and that each of us, no matter how big or small, no matter how old or young, each of us can do the most important job to share your love in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, Amen.
This is a poem written by Paragatuma after the handshake between the Queen and Martin McGuinness in 2012. Shaking hands. Because what's the alternative? Because of courage. Because of loved ones lost. Because no more. Because it's a small thing, shaking hands, it happens every day. Because I heard of one man whose hands haven't stopped shaking since a market day in Oma. Because it takes a second to say hit, but it takes longer, much longer, to be a great leader. Much, much longer. Because shared space without human touching doesn't amount to much. Because it's easier to speak to your own than to hold the hand of someone whose side has been previously described, prescribed, denied. Because it is tough. Because it is tough. Because it is meant to be tough. And this is the stuff of memory, the stuff of hope, the stuff of gesture and meaning and leading. Because it has taken so, so long. Because it has taken land and money and languages and barrels of blood. Because lives have been lost. Because lives have been taken. Because to be bereaved is to be troubled by grief. Because more than two troubled peoples live here. Because I know a woman whose hand hasn't been shaken since she was a man. Because shaking a hand is only a part of the start. Because I know a woman whose touch calmed a man whose heart was breaking. Because privilege is not to be taken lightly. Because this just might be good. Because who said that this would be easy? Because some people love what you stand for. And for some, if you can, they can. Because solidarity means a common hand. Because a hand is only a hand, so hang on to it. So join your much discussed hands. We need this for one small second. So touch, so lead.
A prayer of confession. Let us pray. God Most High, Monarch of a distant kingdom, and yet now near to us through Jesus Christ, we come to share our sadness and our loss, and speak of things that weigh down our hearts. In the time of parting and sorrow, your comfort reaches out towards us. In the coldness of our loss, and our sense of things never returning to how they were, we seek you out, your steadiness and your comfort. In the emptiness, you fill us with love. In the darkness, you bathe us with light. Come, Holy God, take from us the burden of guilt and fear, that we may walk upon your good earth confident of your mercy, embraced by your graciousness. Forgive us, gentle God, for the words and thoughts and deeds which have made this world a little bleaker, a little harsher, a little less humane. Take from us the things that cause us hurt or harm. Remove from us the impulse to selfish actions or unkind behavior. Set us free today to live the life of hope and generosity you wish for all your children. Your word calls us to stand fast in the faith that your people share together. So we turn to it, knowing well that it will uphold and nourish us through this time. Forgive us if we ever forget ourselves and look to another rock than you, or another quarry from which to draw our security. For in you alone is our hope, From you alone is our comfort. Through you alone are nations made whole and strong. And by you alone is our future made secure. Such prayers now we make through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
A reading from 1 Timothy, the Lord's grace to Paul. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength, that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Jesus Christ. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his immense patience as an example for those who would believe in him and receive eternal life. Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honour and glory forever and ever. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Reading from the Gospel according to St. Luke, the parables of the lost sheep and the lost coin. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering round to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, "This man welcomes sinners and eats with them." Then Jesus told them this parable. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who do not need to repent. Or suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin." In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Thanks be to God.
King of kings, Majesty, Savior, closest friend, strong deliverer, beginning and end. All within me falls at your feet. In royal robes,
Let us pray. Almighty God, throughout the changing centuries, your word is eternal. Draw our attention to you now and to the living word, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour, that you would guide us. For in Christ's name we pray. Amen. As the United Kingdom marks the death of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, much has been said over these past few days about her resilience in serving her country for 70 years, the longest reign of any British monarch. My own dim memories as a child aged 7 on Her Majesty's Silver Jubilee in 1977 is of a party at primary school, as well as seeing images of tables and streets on the news. But the Queen herself? The Queen was something far away and very serious. The only other time she seemed to intrude into my childhood was those Christmas broadcasts, when I was forced with my brother to sit quietly while great aunts and uncles watched, when I was desperate to get back to those presents under the tree. The Queen was duty and pomp and ceremony and very annoying to a young boy. She changed that, as every monarch has done to the institution through the centuries, adapting to the social and political pressures of the day. The historian and royal biographer Robert Lacey wrote of her, she had a wonderfully wry and dry sense of humour, and it was very important to her identity. Because of the Queen, an entire generation of children today will remember the monarchy for Paddington Bear and the Queen keeping a marmalade sandwich in her handbag. And I loved her keeping James Bond waiting before she apparently jumped out of a helicopter at the London Olympics in 2012. Lacey went on to write that the Queen, that her sense of humour and her religious faith were two of the personal elements that kept her so much on track. Her Millennium Christmas address was notable for a very personal reflection on her faith, the words printed in your order of service. I know that the only way to live my life is to try to do what is right, to take the long view, to give of my best in all the days that the day brings, and to put my trust in God. It did feel very different, having grown up listening to such formal royal Christmas addresses, to hear the Queen speak in such an informal way about her personal faith. In 2010, she spoke at the opening of the General Synod of the Church of England and said, "At the heart of our faith stand not a preoccupation with our own welfare and comfort, but the concepts of service and of sacrifice as shown in the life and teachings of the one who made himself nothing, taking the very form of a servant." Service to others, which so much of this week will reflect on, is at the heart of our reading from Timothy today. I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who has given me strength that he considered me trustworthy, appointing me to his service. In the service of what? Of being an example that will bring salvation to others. Who is worthy of that? You might think that a 25-year-old young woman confronted with the prospect of becoming the head of the state of a country at a time of international turmoil, as its former empire was tearing itself apart, was daunting enough. But the King of Kings and Lord of Lords has called you to his service for the sake of the salvation of others, and no earthly kingdom can match the glory of that calling, following in the footsteps of Christ. The writer in Timothy holds up the Apostle Paul as an example, the worst of sinners who actively persecuted God's people, blaspheming God by his murderous pursuit of the body of Christ, the church. There was no one worse, and yet perversely, this was the very man who became a servant of Christ, sacrificing himself in the service of others, to seek and save a world that was lost. Our world can feel so lost at the moment. The news from Ukraine, the ongoing disruption and deaths from coronavirus, the cost of living crisis plunging families into debt, a climate crisis that is destroying and displacing untold millions of people across the world, and politics here and across the Western world shaped by such division and hatred that we wonder, can there ever be a leader who can help address the global problems facing our common humanity? Who is up to such things? You are. In St. Giles Cathedral, where Her Majesty's coffin is being brought to today, there is a little three-legged stool. It's there because Charles I decided that his way was the best way, and he sought to impose Anglican prayers on the Church of Scotland. Jenny Geddes was in the church that day, and she was having none of Charles I's nonsense. So she picked up the stool and flung it at the preacher. Here's to more women throwing things at clergy. Because of her, and the riots that ensued afterwards, Charles III had to sign a declaration of the security, an oath for the security of the Church of Scotland. Never think that what you do doesn't matter. We find ourselves as ordinary people caught in the circumstance of life and facing this great challenge. We may wonder if anyone can overcome the lostness of all that is around us, yet we should never give in to fear. God's power can use the weakest and worst of us because God considers you worthy for the task. Allow yourself to grasp this for a moment. You are called because God has already counted you worthy in Christ Jesus. Our gospel lesson was of lost sheep and lost coins today. But remember this, the sheep and the coin already belonged to the one who was searching. They are slightly preposterous stories. All that effort for just one, the neglect of all the others. That's how precious you are to God, says Jesus. For when someone finds their heart returning to God, heaven itself will rejoice. You have always been God's child, no matter how lost you have ever felt. You are privileged with the good news of Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ came to this earth and stood with a lost and broken humanity. He stood with us here that we might stand with him in eternal glory. You are gifted with the same spirit that rescued Paul from his service to death and hate. You are the heirs of a kingdom that will outlast every human institution by the grace of God, who has called each of us to Christ's service. Not only called to serve, but also gifted with all you need and the knowledge that all that you do matters. You are never nobodies, but sisters and brothers of Christ the King. Your legacy is eternal. For who else will know courage except by your hand reaching out to those who the world calls your enemy? Who else will know love except by your sacrifice for others? Who else will know hope except by your perseverance? Who else will know generosity except by your faithful giving? Who else will learn forgiveness unless you are willing to be forgiven and forgive? Such small things at so many times, yet they can change the world. You are worthy of service because the one who died for you has called you. This is the glory and majesty of your own calling as individual Christians, called to serve in the knowledge that God's grace and patience is with us every single moment. And there is no task that can ever defeat God's love. May God grant us all the grace to serve faithfully. Now to the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honour and glory forever and ever. Amen. We worship God with our service and our offering. Let us pray. Generous God, who engages with the world in which we live, we give you thanks that all is known to you and blessed by your eternal presence. God of the past, the present, and the future, for the bedrock of faith, for the deep roots of faith, receive our thanks this day. In times of change and transformation, where we miss the familiar and long for stability, reassure us with the steadfastness of your love. Hear our thanks for the nations of the United Kingdom, its people and its places, the human tapestry of young and old, women and men, the city dweller and the country folk, one people. Enhance our respect for each other, trusting in the inherent goodness that each child of the universe offers to a broken world. Hear our thanks for Elizabeth, the late Queen, for the years of her reign and the sweep of history through which she provided both anchor and springboard. We thank you for her dedication to our nations and Commonwealth, and for all the rich gifts of wisdom, kindness, and inclusion she brought to her long decades. We give you thanks for lives her life touched, for the radiance of her smile and the encouragement of her words. We thank you for the sparkle of her humor that eased the tensions she encountered, and for the determination of her life to see its duties through. Especially, we thank you for those times when she reached across ancient enmities in our land to set an example for each of us to follow. Grant our own leaders courage to reach beyond their fears, that they too may become an example for others of that reconciliation which Jesus Christ brings to the world. King of kings and Lord of lords, for our nations at this time we pray, asking for comfort for those feeling deep loss, and hopefulness as we step forward into the days ahead. As thankfulness mingles with sadness, may we support each other and be, together, communities of tenderness and kindness. Sustain us with the strong memories of the past and prepare us for joyfulness in the days before us. In the dignity of a time of grief, may we find in each other encouragement to share our tears and be consoled by remembering laughter that eases emptiness and speaks to us of life continuing in generations to come. Grant to all those in positions of leadership humility and wisdom in the decisions they must make, and inspire your servants wherever they are to bring hope in times of despair for so many as they live with anxieties of debt and uncertainty. God, save the King, and bless him in these days of preparation. Imbue him with the strength of character, the openness of heart, the suppleness of mind, and the generosity of spirit, that by your grace may anoint him in the coming days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. grant to the living grace, to the departed rest, to Christ's church, the King, the nations of the world and all people, peace and concord, and to us and all God's servants, life everlasting. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and abide with you always. Amen.